growing media in the planet engage with these processes? Just take, let's take one process very quickly. Hunger. The same media that are so thrilled when the judiciary intervenes on a case of a Jessica Lal or a Ruchika Girokra. Excellent, very good. The media are very thrilled about that intervention. The same media write editorials clicking their tongues when the judiciary intervenes on the business of hunger. When it makes a statement, people immediately write editorials saying the judiciary is getting a little too interventionist. I remember an anchor wagging his finger saying that at prime time. The top papers had their economic columns writing, there is clear evidence of all-round improvement at the ground level. At the same time, the three officially constituted committees of the government of India give you, have only one thing in common. They all say that the government of India needs to revise its rural poverty figures upwards from 42%, 50%, and to 77% of the population in less than 2017. But this does not stop the media from creating their reality that things are improving all around on the ground. This year, if you look at it, there's a whole host of rural resurgence stories in the media. Cover stories on India Today, for instance. Rural resurgence. The smallest, I mean, the most conservative of those committees, the Tendulkar Committee, talks about poverty in rural India being higher than the government's estimate by several persons. Child hunger is much more in India, as we all now sadly have had rubbed in, much worse than it is in sub-Saharan Africa. And the empowered group of ministers to discuss food security meets, and the first thing recorded in its minutes is, this is to be a bill on food security. It has nothing to do with nutritional security. This is a bill on food security. Let us delink it from the larger issues of nutritional security. Okay, and one of the ministers, one great gentleman said, what is all this poverty? What is all this hunger? Come to my constituency and see if there is any hunger. His constituency in Maharashtra, by the way, in that division has the largest number of BPL cards. Because he's politically powerful, he can do it in patronage. It has the largest number of BPL cards. Right? But he wants to know what is hunger. So let's discuss what is hunger. Hunger is like we experienced this summer, and now in the rainy period it gets worse, because there's no work to be had. Hunger, just to give you a few faces of it, is mothers in the villages at the height of the heat wave when the government is closing down schools, begging that the schools be kept open at 49 degrees Celsius so that the child will get one decent meal in the day. They want the school to be kept open even during the vacation. And when you go to Telangana, they surround you and say, please use your influence with the collector. Somehow they imagine that I have some. And say, hunger is school teachers telling us, even in urban periphery Mumbai, school teachers telling us, sir, the midday meal ration on Monday should be double on other days. Why? Because the child has starved at home over the weekend of Saturday and Sunday. The last decent meal that child ate was on Friday noon. And the teachers are telling me, no teacher is prepared to teach a class before 1 p.m. on Monday because the child cannot pay attention, sir, that child's stomach is killing it. So until the child has a decent meal on Monday and makes up for not having eaten on 2 days, you can't engage the attention of the child. I think that's hunger. Hunger is when 74-year-old men and 65-year-old widows show up in lines to work on the NREGS. Because their 200 rupee old age pensions have been devastated when tuwar dal reaches 100 rupees a kilogram. Hunger is when those who grow food have no trace for food security. Hunger is the falling income of farm households, which was last estimated in terms of monthly per capita expenditure, monthly 503 rupees per farm household in this country, out of which 60% is spent on food. While people write editorials celebrating, higher prices are good for farmers. No? 75% of farmers in this country are net purchasers of food grain on the market. And therefore, major shifts in prices affect them very, very seriously. Hunger is massive job losses, which have been on in this country for 18 years. Let's take the pre-recession period of the most industrialized state of Maharashtra. Please read its government economic survey of 2008-09. Before the recession began, in 36 months, Maharashtra lost 2 million jobs. It comes in one line. Total employment reduced from 4.3 crore to 4.1 crore. You can just overlook it. That's just 0.2. That's 2 million jobs. That means Maharashtra has been bleeding at 1,800 jobs per day. Imagine the implications of that for hunger. How do the media engage with this issue of hunger at all? How do they engage with agriculture? 200,000 farm suicides between 97 and 2008. 8 million people quit agriculture between the two censuses. We will know the new figure in a few months from now. Attempted suicides at many times the rate of actual suicide. A dramatic doubling of indebtedness between 1991 and 2002, and we do not know further. Agricultural credit is up. Every finance minister has boasted that he has doubled and tripled it, and he's always given you absolute numbers and not percentages. Here's a new figure on agricultural credit. Maharashtra, home of the minister, Union Minister for Agriculture. 2008 data on agriculture are out, agricultural credit are out in Maharashtra. 50% of what you call agricultural credit was disbursed in banks, in urban and metro banks, most of it in Mumbai, in the farming heartland of Mumbai. We're all contract farmers, we farm contracts. 50% of what is called agricultural, and who writes this story? It's not a journalist, it's an RBI officer who's doing research. An RBI researcher publishes this in the Hindu on August 30th. 50% of agricultural credit being disbursed in the urban areas, in the urban and metro bank branches. Most of it has been cornered by two companies. You get prizes for guessing which ones. They're both known for their service to humankind and rural India in particular. Agriculture and the media. I've given you this example before of having six journalists cover the worst year of suicides, 2006, when Maharashtra saw 4,453 farm suicides. Six journalists were covering the Vidarbha region, which, by the way, just so that you get a sense of what Vidarbha is like, Vidarbha is more than two times the size of the state of Kerala. The six affected districts out of 11 districts are bigger than Punjab. They're bigger than the Punjab by 2005. It's not a small place. We're talking about something that is bigger than many European countries. Six journalists were covering it for a week. I chose a week because that was the time of the Lakme Fashion Week, which was being covered by 512 accredited journalists. Now, the Center for Media Studies lab, the CMS lab, has given us some numbers on coverage of agriculture in the last 4 years, 5, 6, 7, and 8, in top Indian newspapers and top Indian channels. Here we are, 2005, 0.1%, 2006, 0.6%, 2007, 0.19%, 2008, 0.29%. 2006, it went up to 0.6%. That's because the Prime Minister visited Vidarbha. Covering the Prime Minister became covering agriculture. And that's really what happened. So you can, whichever way you look at it, it's how we are engaging with the great processes of our time. In newspapers, the percentage, by the way, the newspapers fare better than television. And, surprise, English newspapers fare better than the Hindi newspapers in coverage of agriculture. Don't ask me why. How do we cover the most dominant process of our time, absolutely the most dominant process? Inequality. It's just stunning. The inequality in this country is stunning. You take the case that India now is fifth in the world in dollar billionaires. 49 dollar billionaires who account for between 1/4 and 1/3 of your gross domestic product, or equivalent to it, that would be more accurate to say, whose wealth is equivalent to about 1/3 of your gross domestic product. And you are 134th in the Human Development Index. Four of the world's 10 richest men are Indians, which is more than there are. That's more Indians than Americans on the list. One of them, my favorite, lives in Mumbai and has built the greatest residence that anyone has ever built, to a height of 27 floors, built to a height of 60 floors, each floor tastefully done in a different style. One floor a Rajasthani Haveli, one a Baroque, Italian Baroque thing, one a French villa, whatever. It's a modest residence with only three helipads so far. It cost an estimated $2 billion to build, and in a city where more than 50% of the population lives in the slums of the streets, you could have housed a considerable part of the city's street-based population with $2 billion. Much of Dharavi's makeover could have been done in $2 billion, but Mukesh Bhai built his house.